Hello, everyone, and those who do not know me, I'm Anil George. I'm an NCLEX trainer from the US with the last 20 years experience teaching NCLEX. Myself did my CGFNS in 2000. For the last 20 years, I have been involved with the NCLEX RN training. And I think I have learned a lot how to effectively prepare for any of these licensing exams, you know, including all the exams for the Middle East. I'm sure most of you are preparing for your MOH, DHA, HAD. As you know, all those exams are basically focused on the NCLEX exam format itself. And I'm sure my long experience, plus my working experience from the US, as well as my master's in nursing education from the US would be a great asset for you to learn a lot how to effectively prepare for your licensing exams for anywhere in the Middle East. From my long-term experience, what I could understand, probably, you know, some of you would have been out from your nursing school or nursing college for quite some time, and maybe would have forgotten, you know, what you learned in your nursing program. And also, you know, it's a lot of content. I mean, it's so many different subjects, right? We study that over 3 to 4 years. Yeah, it's too much. And so what do we study for this licensure exam, which is a challenging question. And I think that's where I can probably guide you with my extended experience of teaching, plus my passion for teaching. And one of the problems, you know, I identified. So suppose, you know, after your nursing program, your BSc or diploma, some of you may have even master's. Okay. So after that, maybe you're working in a particular area. Maybe you are working in, you know, operating room, or maybe you're working in psychiatry, or you're working in maternity. So when you work in those areas, particularly if it's for a long time, you get detached from other areas. I mean, someone who is working in maternity could be an expert in maternity, but she would have forgotten a major part of medical surgical nursing or psychiatric nursing, and vice versa. So this is a problem. But for this exam, they test you on all these major areas, and particularly it is focused on medical surgical nursing, pediatric, psychiatric, and you know, maternity nursing. So we should have a thorough understanding of all those areas. Okay? And so they do test that in all these areas. Okay? Another big challenge I identified, the students try to memorize all this information. I mean, we need to know all them, but don't memorize. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Do not memorize. Let me just show you something here. I'm not sure how many of you have heard this, but having this understanding will really help you understand what I'm actually talking here. I mean, as you can see, do you see a pyramid here with the 6 different levels? And what do you see there? It's called the Bloom's taxonomy. So, you know, the information we have learned over this 3 or 4 years of our nursing program, so they could be tested at different levels on these licensure exams. So sometimes you may see a straight question. I mean, you know, how many bones are there in a body, right? I think every single nurse, I mean, those who have done their anatomy in the first year know that information. But is that really important on your licensure exam? Good to know, but it's not a must. Because that's not the way how the questions come on these licensure exams. And that's where we have to prepare based on how they will frame the question. So the question I asked you, you know, how many bones? So what we call as the knowledge, that's at the very bottom, the information at the very lower level. And then it goes into comprehension. You do not know the information, but when you see that particular information in a question, or you understand, okay, I know what it is. So that's at the comprehension. And then you see the next level, what we call the application analysis. Those are the questions that are of higher level on this licensure exams. And that's where you see a lot of this, you know, prioritization principles. So I'm going to talk a little bit on how to prioritize in this lesson as well. Okay? Because a lot of students get challenged. I mean, just look into your clinical scenario. You know, we have 10 different patients to take care of at the same time. I mean, do we have 20 different hands to take care of these 10 patients at the same time? No, we don't have. We had to know whom we should see first, or whom we can delay a little bit. So that's where we had to start prioritizing, you know, our patient care needs. I mean, when someone is short of breath, we had to take care of that person instead of someone who says, oh, I want to go to the bathroom right away. I mean, it is definitely important to go to the bathroom, but it is much more important to make sure our patient who is short of breath is relieved from the shortness of breath, because this is a lifesaver. So that's where we need to understand these principles of prioritization. We know this information, but somehow our preparation in our nursing programs has not been emphasized on these principles. But understanding this is so important, as I told you, it's a lifesaver. So this lesson, what I'm talking here, you know, it is not just into med surg, it is not into pediatric, it is not into psych, it is into all the different content area and all the different test area we're going to see in our licensure exam. Whether it is your MOH or DHA or HAD or NCLEX, they all have the same principles we use to prioritize, because that can save our patient's life. So we're going to talk about several such principles of prioritization in this lesson as well. And the first one we're going to see here is principle of ABC. And I'm sure every single of you know what it is, right? We have learned that from the very first year of nursing. But also, some of you may think, I mean, we heard the ABC was changed into CAB something. Yeah, you're right. Yes. Since 2010, the American Heart Association have changed ABC into CAB, or what they call CAB. That is true. But for the licensure exams, you still see the ABC in most of the questions. But then where does this CAB, the CAB, comes from? I mean, imagine we have a patient found unconscious on the street. Are you going to really give a mouth-to-mouth to that person? I mean, I don't think so. I mean, now that everyone is aware of corona and other, you know, droplet conditions and other airborne conditions, I don't think anyone will even dare to do that. I mean, what is the maximum we may do? We may do a chest compression. But even giving that chest compression can be a real lifesaver. I mean, do you know the fact? When someone becomes unconscious, we do have adequate oxygen in our body with which we can function for at least 10 minutes, provided we can keep the heart pumping. So that's where this compression has a higher priority based on this 2010, you know, American Heart Association recommendation. But again, that is applicable more in a clinical scenario. But for the licensure exam, you can still go by the ABC. And also, let me tell you, when you see this ABC, you have to understand. I will recommend and emphasize in all my lessons, I teach you based on the pathophysiology of each disease condition. For example, I'm going to ask you a simple question, what you can see right here on the screen. So imagine we have a patient admitted with the asthma exacerbation. Which of these given interventions will be the first priority for the patient? And you can see oxygen, solimedrol, albuterol. And when I raise this question to my students, you know what the most common response I get from majority? Oxygen. Because they think asthma, they are short of breath. Okay, they cannot breathe. Let me give them some oxygen. Well, nothing wrong in it. But you need to understand the disease condition based on the pathophysiology. What is actually happening in asthma? So let's look into this image which follows, and that might help you understand what asthma is. You see how the normal airway appear, which is, you know, widely open, is allowing the free flow of air in and out. But look into the asthmatic airway, you can see it's kind of narrowed, it has a lot of mucus, so airflow will be very difficult in and out. Haven't you heard, a patient with an asthma attack, they can go into respiratory acidosis. It's another major, you know, exam topic, right? The acidosis, alkalosis. Yeah, a patient with an asthma attack, they can go into respiratory acidosis. And why does that happen? Because they're going to retain too much of carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide cannot come out because of the constriction or the narrowing. So that's where we need to start to open up the airway. I mean, going back into the question, again, the three options, oxygen, solimedrol, and albuterol. So probably some of you thought oxygen, but I'm telling you here, oxygen is not the best answer. And the best answer in this situation is albuterol. And why? We know the problem with the asthma attack, it is narrowed airway. We need to open up the airway. That's the ABC airway we're talking. It's not just oxygen. Don't misinterpret the information. So that can, you know, misguide you and get you wrong response on your licensure exams. As I told you, we need to open up the airway, and for that, albuterol might be the best option if it is readily available. Because by action, we know albuterol is a bronchodilator. And again, as I told you, nothing wrong in giving oxygen at the same time. But albuterol will open up the airway and it will allow the free flow of air in and out. And also, you may wonder what this medicine solimedrol is. Most of you also might know it's a corticosteroid which can help to reduce the inflammation. But it also might take a couple days for full effect. So out of all these three, the best option is albuterol itself. Another important principle I'm going to talk here is the Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. You can see the human needs categorized into five different levels. And what are they? At the very bottom is physiological needs. And then there is safety, then love, belongingness, self-esteem and self-actualization. You know what happened? A lot of times one option comes under the physiological needs at the very bottom. And when we say physiological, think about oxygen, you know, water, food, they all are the physiological needs. And we know that we need them. It's like, I would say this is like the foundation of a building. Can a building sustain without its foundation? No, it'll collapse. The same way, we cannot survive without meeting the physiological needs. They are the most foundational or the most basic. And the next priority in the list is safety. It is important, but it's not as important as meeting the physiological needs. And then you see the three on the top, love, belongingness, self-esteem, self-actualization. Yes, definitely good to have them. You know, we want to be respected, we want to be loved, we want to feel proud of ourselves. Yes, we need all those things. But will we die if you don't get them? No, we would be frustrated, we would be unhappy. We won't be as productive as we would be, but still we can survive. I mean, those three on the top, they are called the psychosocial needs. So how do we use this in the question? So as I told you, a lot of times one option comes from the physiological need, or maybe one from the safety area. And the three on the top, I told you they are psychosocial. Usually it's a lesser priority on the given questions. Maybe out of the four, one is physiological, one is safety, and the other three are psychosocial, which we can probably neglect, you know, if the other needs are a priority. And also, have you heard, even pain is a psychosocial need. Think about a patient after surgery. It is normal, it is expected the patient will have pain, but will that pain kill that patient? No, because it's a psychosocial need, right? I mean, 10 different people in the operating room, they all may have different pain perception. I mean, haven't you heard, pain is subjective. So what I feel about pain is different from what you feel about pain, right? And it can vary from, you know, male to female, from, you know, based on the races, culture, they all can affect our pain perception. So that's why pain is considered as a psychosocial. But don't misinterpret that with the pain we may get with the MI. So the pain we may get, you know, with the myocardial infarction, heart, so that's called a physiological pain. So that pain, if we don't address at the same time, or maybe in a minute or so, our patient is dead. So that is definitely a physiological pain, that's a bodily need. So because that indicates something terrible is happening in our body. But otherwise, pain is considered as a psychosocial need. I believe you've been learning something useful by this time. And let's look into another important principle. We can see what we call principle of triage, which is categorizing patients based on the severity of illness. And I'm sure you all would have been to the emergency room, right? At least once in your lifetime. So when you go there, won't you get checked by the triage nurse or the emergency room doctor? Yeah, so what they do, they categorize the patients based on the severity. I mean, someone coming with a chest pain or shortness of breath definitely get a higher priority than someone coming with a maybe, you know, had a fall, the ankle hurts, or there's a belly pain. So those patients can wait a little bit more. Yes, based on the triage principle, they're going to focus on something that is more, you know, concerning to the life than problems related to the rest of the body. And this principle we just heard also can be emphasized in the next principle we're going to talk, whichever is life-saving or that reduces morbidity is taken care of first. Okay. So when you see these different patients presenting with different health problems, ask yourself, if that patient is going to die, I mean, imagine our four patients, let them be whomever, whatever, but ask yourself, if I don't see patient A, is that patient going to die? B, C, and D, if any of them will die, then definitely we have to take care of that patient first. So that's what we're talking here, which is life-saving. And you know, a lot of times this also would be some problems related to our vital organs, maybe to our lungs, to our heart, to the brain. So problems relating to these are generally more life-threatening, and we may have to give a higher priority in that case. But then always, it is not a life-threatening condition. So maybe they have a problem on the extremity, and I'm sure I can give you a good example, and I'm sure those who work in the orthopedic areas would have definitely heard about this condition called compartment syndrome, you know, where there is too much of pressure building up in a muscle compartment, you know, one of the extremities, whether upper or lower, and it's very likely to happen with the burns patient, with a tight cast, or with the trauma. So this increasing pressure, if you don't address in the right time, it can cause nerve damage and probably can make that extremity disabled. And this is what we call as compartment syndrome, a condition that should be identified immediately. And sometimes they had to undergo this operation, what you can see here, what we call as fasciotomy. Okay, so they will put a straight incision to relieve the pressure. Yeah, it looks like a terrible surgery, but it can save their extremity if it's done on the right time. If it is delayed, you know, they can end up with a dysfunctional extremity. So that is not going to kill the person, but they're going to end up with some sort of disability. So when you see these four typical options, you know, consider whichever is life-threatening, and that should be given the first priority. And if you don't see anything life-threatening, then you consider if the problem can cause a permanent disability. Or simply speaking, life over limb. Remember, we can live without our extremities, but we cannot live without our vital organs. That's why life over limb. So when you see those questions, you know, consider these, if these principles get applied, and definitely we had to choose something more life-threatening than a problem related to the rest of the body. And also, let me get you a few other classic tips that can really help you prioritize. So you can see, you know, actual or potential. Okay. When you see these questions and the options, ask yourself, is that particular problem a current problem or is it a potential problem? An example, we were talking about the patient with the asthma attack. So patient with asthma attack, they could be short of breath. That is an actual problem. Versus consider a patient getting Coumadin. I mean, I believe everyone knows what is Coumadin or the warfarin, right? The anticoagulant. And also you might know, you know, patient is on warfarin or Coumadin. We check their PT, INR, and we had to closely monitor that, usually on a daily basis or less frequent as it progresses. When we have those two options, consider which is a current problem or an actual problem first, then a potential problem. So yeah, the patient with the Coumadin and high INR, the patient can wait a little bit more until we take care of our patient who is short of breath. Another important principle we can use, if it is expected or unexpected. Think about a medication. I mean, when we talk about medication, we know medications can have dozens of side effects. So some of the side effects are, you know, commonly expected. Versus if there is something unexpected. You can get to your best example. Think about a narcotic analgesic. And probably everyone know what morphine, right? Okay, so morphine, the narcotic analgesic. So when a patient is on any narcotic analgesic, it is very likely the patient can develop constipation. And why? Because narcotic analgesics are CNS depressants. So with the CNS depression, the peristalsis can slow down. So it's going to cause constipation, which is normal and which is expected. But this patient getting morphine, going into respiratory depression, it is unexpected. So we know it's an adverse effect. So in that case, that should be taken care before handling this problem of constipation, which is expected. And this particular principle doesn't just apply to medications alone. You can also consider this with the given disease condition. For example, I'm sure most of you know what Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. And a patient with one of these conditions, I'm sure you know they can get these loose stools or the abdominal cramps, which is normal and expected. But if that patient get a fever, is that expected? No. It could be a possible complication. It shows an ongoing inflammation. If you don't address that in the right time, maybe it can lead into an extended inflammation, perforation, peritonitis, and death. You see the difference? The abdominal cramps and the loose stools, that is expected. But the fever is unexpected. So this principle is extremely useful, particularly when we talk about medications and into the symptoms in various disease conditions. Okay. And one last principle I will talk here in this context is the steps in nursing process. And I'm sure every single of you know what nursing process is, right? And particularly we talk about the five different steps, and you can simply remember it as AD pie, or we call it as a delicious pie, okay? A delicious pie, yes. A for assessment, and D for diagnosis, B for planning, I for implementation, and E for evaluation. And in a lot of given situations, the answer is assessment, the first step. I can give you an example. Think about a patient with the diabetes. And this patient is starting to shake and sweat. Likely, no, the patient is having hypoglycemia. Based on our practice, we may think, oh, let me get you the patient some orange juice or maybe a candy. But that's not right for this licensure exams. As a nurse, we need to start assessing the patient. Maybe we had to check the blood sugar. We need to do a finger stick, check the sugar. If it is low, we give the sugar supplements. If it is something else, we treat accordingly. So it should start with an assessment. But don't think that's how it is always. It could vary too. So for example, in an emergency situation, we don't wait to get a full assessment. So think about a patient with congestive heart failure, patient lying flat in the bed, patient cannot breathe. Are we going to listen to the patient's lungs? No. We simply make the patient sit up. Just by changing the position itself, the patient can breathe better, patient can function better. So remember, all these rules we talk also have some exemptions based on the given situations. So I hope I was really able to give you some useful tips on your licensure exam preparation, whether it is a MOH, DHA, HAD, NCLEX, whichever it is, because they all are based on the same foundation. Okay. So this is how we should prepare for these exams. We should know the content. We're going to go through them step by step. You know, wherever we are weak, we're going to look into them. We're going to have a lot of instructional videos on those harder content, which is difficult for you to understand. And I'm going to come back with several of such videos on the way. But at the same time, remember, even when we know the content, make sure you use these principles of prioritization while we talk. So any questions, feel free to clarify through the comment box, and I'll be able to help you in the due time. And thanks for watching the Kamal RN Licensure Preparation Review Program, and please do come back. We're going to have a lot more useful videos in our coming sessions.